You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, your portal to the science fiction multiverse. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, Mr. and Mrs. America and all the ships at sea, conversationalists across the fruited plain, captains courageous, princes of the universe, ladies who lunch, the people on the wrong side of the tracks, it's Open Line Friday. And we have a short-ish show today. We only can do an hour because I've got to go pick up the truck from the shop. So we're just going to dive right into it. Welcome to the program, ladies and gentlemen. All the usual things. We're live. YouTube, Odyssey, Rumble. Dive in the live chat. I am going to put the link in the chat if I can get my mouse to cooperate there. I will put it in the chat, and we will start going, like, immediately. So here we go. Let me put it in here, and we will power through this. And let's see. I can pin that one. I can't pin it in Rumble, but I don't know that anybody is over there. So here we go. Lots of things to talk about this week happening. If you guys want to do a Sydney Sweeney simpcast, I guess we could do that. We can talk about Disney. We can talk about Ed Piskor a little bit. We can talk about Marvel and the Silver Surfer casting. There's stuff to talk about. And there's stuff from previous weeks. If anybody wants to do that. It is your show today. Open Line Friday means you can call in and you can jump in and spout off on whatever it is. It's a rant, a rave, a complaint, a question, stump the host. I mean, anything. Pledge your life savings. Anything that you want to do. Email address, livefromthebunker@sci-fi4me.com. All the social medias, the Discord. Join us over on Discord. And jump in the conversations there. If you're not with us live, you can still leave a comment. So we're all good. Brandon Morse, let me start this. Brandon Morse has a show. He's over at Red State. He has a show over on Rumble called Brandon Morse's Brand Risk. I was watching it this morning. He played a clip from the old Frasier show. And I'm going to steal from that a little bit. Frasier is talking about this very super powerful electron microscope at Cornell University. And this microscope has the power to dial down and see at the atomic level. And I'm going to sit here and say that if I were to use that powerful telescope, I would still not be able to find any sympathy for Alex DeCampi and Mark Wade and that crowd. I'm just saying. All right, let's jump everybody in here. Christopher Hoffman is here. I'm going to throw Cam in. We're just going to mix it up. Let's go, gentlemen. How's it going? How are you?
I'm doing well. Hopefully you're doing good.
Hanging in. How's it going, Cam?
Howdy.
All right, so what are we going to be complaining about today? What's the topic? What do you guys want to talk about?
I've got a
go for it.
You know what? I'm hearing an echo.
Are you? I'm not hearing anything.
I'm hearing an echo as well.
I'm not hearing it on my end, so I'm not sure where it would be coming from. I've only got one line of Winky Blinkies. Is everybody else hearing an echo? Okay, Mazers does not hear an echo on the stream.
I was hearing an echo from Cam. So.
Do what?
Not a second season.
By the way, while we're figuring this out, let me pop this up here. I have updated our days without incident sign. Look at that, 357 days. We are Magnum today. 357 days without an incident. Nobody has stepped on anything or fallen on anything, and I don't know how long that's gonna last. So anyway,
let me pop out and try again.
Okay. All right. So Christopher, what do you want to talk about?
I wanted to bring up this news that just occurred recently. I think either like yesterday or the last couple of days. It involves KISS, and I bring up KISS because, you know, they've done movies, comics, all of that stuff.
Right.
Apparently they have sold everything, their intellectual property, their brand, and all of their song licenses, to a Swedish investment group called Pop House for $300 million.
This is the band KISS?
And Pop House has already indicated that they might be interested in doing what is called an avatar show with the KISS likenesses. And that's sort of like the 3D hologram shows.
Oh, right. Well, I knew they were doing the avatar thing.
It looks like Gene Simmons and the rest of the members of KISS. I mentioned Gene specifically because he was always the businessman of the group.
Yeah.
They've sold everything.
$300 million. Wow. All right. This is Variety from yesterday.
I do know that they recently went on a retirement tour, but this actually looks like they're officially retired. They're out of the music.
Yeah. Huh. Okay.
Game, at least, individually.
Hang on just a second. I want to check something here real quick. Okay. All right. Christopher, can you hear me okay? Do you have an echo for me?
No, I don't have an echo from you.
Okay. All right. Rock and Roll Hall of Famers KISS sold their music catalog, name, image, and likeness, including their iconic makeup designs, to Pop House Entertainment, Sweden-based music investment firm behind ABBA's Voyage hologram show. While terms of the deal were not officially announced, Bloomberg and Associated Press said it was worth upwards of $300 million. You know, I'm looking at this story. This is yesterday, and I seem to recall a few weeks ago How long ago was it that I saw that they were doing the big digital holographic avatars? Because this is a thing that they've been working on for a while. Maybe it was just, we're working on this proof of concept, and now you guys proved that you could do it, so we're going to sell it to you. Maybe. I don't know. But I want to say that they've been working on the holographic avatars for a while, because we had that story, I want to say a month and a half ago.
Well, I do know that they have done Ronnie James Dio, as well as Tupac Secure, and they've done like hologram concerts.
Yeah.
With them, okay. I mean, not together.
Yeah. Here's the thing I'm thinking of. Probably
that technology.
It says here, Kiss teased their forthcoming.
I'm not sure if it was Pop House Entertainment or another company.
It was probably Pop House. It says here, Kiss teased their forthcoming digital show with the final concert of their End of the Road tour in New York last year when avatar versions of the band closed the show. That's what I'm thinking about. That's what we saw. That was the thing. That was the thing when they did that big announcement, because we looked at the video on that, and it doesn't look all that impressive. It doesn't look like Kiss. It looks like... really bad knockoff anime Gundam type avatars. I mean, it's not a very good represent. It's not a very good likeness of them at all. So I don't know.
Yeah, actually, I'm sorry. Let me go back a little bit and separate the two. The avatar shows are, I guess, based more on like a Japanese Vocaloid performance.
Yeah.
Where you have like a anime-type character performing songs. Then the 3D holograms are actually captured likenesses of the different performers. When I mentioned Ronnie James Dio and Tupac, they were doing the 3D captured, not necessarily the characters true. Avatar shows.
Yeah, you're cutting in and out a lot, Christopher. I'm not sure what's causing that, but just to let you know,
I'm hearing. At first, I was only hearing you through one stereo channel.
Yeah,
I turned up the volume on my speakers a little bit, then I was hearing you through the other one.
Okay, if you're on speakers and not headphones, that might be what's causing it.
Check my end.
If you're on speakers and not headphones, that may be what's causing it, because your microphone might be picking up your speakers and doing a dampening type of thing, audio ducking stuff. So you might want to check that.
All right.
All right. Meanwhile, let's bring Michael into the mix. Let me slide over here. Michael, welcome, sir. How are you?
Hi there. I'm a little late, came in, and you started talking about Kiss and I guess computer generated art or AI generated art.
Yeah, Kiss is going to be doing. They've just sold their entire library catalog and their likenesses to a Swedish company that's doing the ABBA hologram shows. They're going to do it for Kiss now, and they're going to do these digital holographic avatars that I guess Kiss will live forever now.
Yeah. for good or bad.
All right, let's bring Cam back in here and see if that's gonna do it. All right, Cam, how are you, sir? Is that better?
I think I'm messed up because everyone is echoing except for Jason.
Everybody is echoing. Okay, are you guys? Yeah, are you guys going? Are you
booted myself?
Are you guys going with headphones or just speakers? Because sometimes that creates a feedback loop that causes a problem.
Just speakers. My headphone set isn't working, so I
well that could be what's place. That could be what's causing the echo then, maybe.
I have headphones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because if the speakers are close enough to the microphone picks up the speakers and there's a delay, and so it starts looping back and forth, and so that's where the echo comes from.
Yeah, well, I'm on a laptop, so the speakers and the microphone are placed where they're placed. That's my problem.
All right. Yeah, Snob was right. We did have 20 minutes of tech stuff. Yes.
Michael, are you echoing as well?
Yes. No, actually, I'm not. It doesn't seem like it. Yeah, I guess not. Good. Okay. My quickie comment was, Chris, and for Jason, the history of doing the AI, you know, you guys know more about the tech, maybe. I know that they've been doing it since Star Wars, since the new Star Wars movies. But what I wanted to point out is that it was going on even before that. There was a 50th anniversary concert for the sci-fi album, Jeff Wayne's musical version of The War of the Worlds.
Mm-hmm.
They did a 40th anniversary, say, back around 2013, 2012, something like that. And what they did is that they brought Richard Burton back from the dead. They slapped his voice. They put an AI generate. They put some sort of computer AI generated face. It wasn't very good at the time.
Yeah.
But if you look at, they have a video of it, you can see. But they had his lips moving in sync with the spoken portions of the album, where they're not going into song. The singers from Thin Lizzy and the Moody Blues doing their songs. So the thing is that, yeah, this is going to be here. It's to stay, and it's already been around now for more than 10 years.
Yeah, because they've done it. They've done it with Tupac. They've done it with Michael Jackson.
Right. My thing is that it's been going on a lot. It's longer even than most people would think, because most people would point to the deep fake from Rogue One with what's her name, Carrie Fisher. Yeah. It's kind of like the first time it's in public awareness. But geeky wise, like me, it's been going on even before that.
Right. Well, okay. So now the thing about it is, though, face replacement and that kind of CG stuff is a lot different from digital avatar holographic thing in a concert. That's a completely different kind of technology.
True. But well,
it wasn't just Carrie Fisher's face. I mean, they recreated Peter Cushing throughout that entire film too, and it looked really creepy.
Oh, believe me, the Richard Burton looked even creepier. It's a great album. It was great to see the live concert. I've got a copy of it. The thing is, like Kiss, who are old farts by now, the same thing with I can't remember the guy from Thin Lizzy, but still, anyways, the thing is that, yeah, these are singers from the 60s and 70s, and they're reprising the roles, and it's like, well, they're not going to be around too much longer.
Yeah.
With Kiss and the deal that they made with Pop House, they sold everything. I mean, all of their brands, their intellectual property, and their songs. So essentially, Pop House owns Kiss in its entirety, as far as the intellectual property, the visual acts, and everything like that. So it seems that the band itself is like no longer going to be affiliated with Kiss as we know it in the public consciousness. So it's like George Lucas selling off Lucasfilms,
yeah,
and stuff like that. And with Kiss, you know, I mean, they made a huge fortune off of their branding, and they had like comic books, action figures, all of this. They were one of the first rock bands to really capitalize on merch outside of just like t-shirts and records and stuff like that.
Yeah, I think the George Lucas comparison is apt because it's, you know, I built this thing. It's a very successful thing. It makes a ton of money. And now I'm going to sell it and get out of it completely. I would imagine that the deal probably includes some kind of residuals. I mean, if I were Gene Simmons, and Gene Simmons is a very smart businessman, if I were Gene Simmons, I would say, yes, here, you're going to buy the catalog, you're going to buy our likenesses, you're going to own everything, and also, you're going to pay us a percentage of any money that you make for perpetuity for as long as you own it, for as long as we're alive. I mean, that to me is almost a given that would be a requirement in there. Say, hey, you know, yeah, fine, give us $300 million, and then every year you're gonna write us a check for everything that you made this year. So,
oh yeah, I wouldn't doubt that Gene Simmons included like a clause like that in the deal contract itself. He's really shrewd when it comes to. Yeah. To like business ventures and stuff like that.
Yeah. All right, Cam, have you got your audio issues figured out yet?
Let's see.
Are we still? Is everybody echoing still?
Yeah, everyone except for you. So
everybody but me.
I think I'm out of luck.
So I guess you guys are all messed up.
the thing I was going to say, Chris, is, but Heaven and Jason. Haven't like the Rolling Stones and Aerosmith been dead for like 10 or 20 years already? My bad joke for the day.
They got replaced by pod people back in 1968, I think.
Yeah, and the thing is that it's all been their if you will, stage performance. The only band that came back from the dead in public notoriety, in my opinion, was Devo with their very last album after not having done any new work in 20 years. Their last album, Fresh, which was in 2009, it was pretty darn good, and they came back with new corporate costumes.
Yeah.
This time it was the blue mask over their head and the blue overalls, which worked well considering Mossberg was getting pretty fat there.
Yeah,
and but I'm, still,
Michael, was, I'm actually starting to hear quite a bit of an echo with you now too. So,
dun dun.
I may have to kick all of you out.
No, I'm actually looking at the settings for StreamYard on my end. And they've got like a new setting that says reduce mic background noise, as well as, of course, the square for echo cancellation and stereo audio.
Yeah, those are not.
I don't know if I'm still echoing or not.
Nobody's echoing for. Well, now I'm starting to get an echo on my end. For me, I'm hearing an echo somewhere. It's probably coming from. I don't know who it's coming from. I tell you what, hang on, Christopher, mute your microphone for just a second. Let me see what that does. If we track this down, see who it's coming from. 1, 2, 3. Because Michael's got his microphone muted, so it's probably on your end where we're getting this echo. Maybe. No. I mean, mute the StreamYard. Hit your mute button in StreamYard. Not on. There we go. Yep, there it is. Yeah, so the echo, it looks like it's coming from your end. Maybe, I don't know.
I'm the worst.
Well, it's probably Chris. No, wait, I'm still hearing it. No, wait. Is it there? No, now I'm not hearing it.
So all right, let me tell you imagine, the tale of. Homer, am I echoing during this tale telling?
No, you're not echoing now. I'm thinking that Christopher's microphone is picking up his speakers. So that's probably where the echo is coming from.
Okay. Well, the thing is that I'm here every time that I'm hearing Michael or Cam, they're echoing as well.
Okay.
So anyway,
that's very weird. That's very strange.
I will duck out and say goodbye.
Well,
thank you for bringing the story though, Chris.
Sci-Fi Snap says this could be a bit. Yeah. Okay, but yeah, I'm hearing an echo from everywhere now. So the plan is at some point very soon to go back to using Zoom instead of StreamYards because I like Zoom better. So that might take care of some of these issues. So Sci-Fi Snob joins us as well. Hello, sir. How are you?
Good.
Are you sure?
You bet. I just had to unmute myself.
All right. So are you hearing echoes from anybody on your end now that you've joined the call? 1, 2, 3.
My own a little bit.
Okay. All right. Well, it may be StreamYard doing it to everybody then.
Maybe.
Snob, do you hear me echoing?
Yeah, you are. But you weren't on YouTube.
See, that's weird because I don't hear an echo on this end from much of anybody. So, I don't know.
Okay, since this is now a bit, should I use like a Lou Costello voice? Like, I bet.
Right.
Yeah, everything's doubled.
I break your arm. You say who's on first.
So, Jason takes that week off in 2 weeks, I'm going to replace his Live from the Bunker. We'll call it Live from Another Bunker or something. And we'll just get on for an hour each day and talk about and just try to fix the tech stuff.
Listen, if you want to stream, go ahead. I mean, we're waiting for new material on your channel so I can promote your channel. So, by the way, everybody, Sci-Fi Snob has a YouTube channel. He says, allegedly.
It's true. There is one. I get more people when I don't post anything. So I'm going back to that. I was waiting for
an insult. Yeah. Okay, I'm not hearing an echo from anybody at the moment, so I think we're good.
Yes, maybe. No one's talking.
Well, everybody's got their mics muted except you.
Correct. I was not talking.
So anyway, all right. What else are we going to talk about? Well, we got 30 minutes before I got to bail.
I've been watching Stranger Things. Just finished the first season, so.
Mm-hmm. What do you think?
That's kind of an old show.
I haven't watched it yet.
You should watch it.
I haven't seen it yet. I hear good things about it. I just haven't had time to do it.
Yeah, it's kind of a mainstream science fiction with a little bit of horror. It's well written, well acted. Everything's good about it. It's not the greatest thing ever, but the fact that it is not bad compared to, Star Trek Discovery or whatever, then I would say watch it. It's, very good, I would rate it.
Well, I think into season 2, season 3, don't they lean into the horror stuff too pretty heavily?
I've just seen the first season and like the first episode of season 2.
Okay.
I think the first season leaned fairly well into the horror. I don't know if it's more in the second seasons, but
I don't know. Have any of the rest of you watched Stranger Things? Have y'all looked at that?
Yeah, I've watched all 4 seasons.
Okay.
And
I watched the first season.
It's getting more fun, and not even because of the D&D thing, but because of the Cthulhu-like references, even though it's not really Cthulhu.
That's it's Cthulhu light, right?
Yeah, well, it's pretty dark. I mean, the main villain / creature, whatever you want to call it, it's an extra dimensional kind of thing going on there. So it's been. I'm not saying anything else. It's just pretty cool. And especially, I love the 80s soundtrack. I bought the season 4 soundtrack because it's just so good, and Susie and the Banshees is in it.
I have to wonder if the kids in that show wearing the Ghostbusters costumes in the Halloween episode, I'm wondering if that, the reaction to that, the response to that, helped Sony make a decision to do another Ghostbusters. If somebody says, look how positive everybody's responding to the Ghostbusters. It's time to do one. I don't know.
I wouldn't doubt it.
Yeah.
And that there's a lot of, nostalgia in play within Stranger Things, although it is like a period piece. The writers have done a good job of, keeping it kind of like period accurate and stuff like that. Although I hadn't really seen any sort of like cloth Ghostbusters uniforms during Halloween when it first kind of came out. They were still kind of like Ben Cooper-esque, like the bibs and the plastic masks, that sort of thing. But that being said, since we're doing like cosplay now and stuff like that, it's a good sort of artistic liberty. There is like a ton of references. There are a ton of references to D&D. In fact, like some of the main villains are described as D&D villains in Stranger Things, like Vecna, for instance, and that sort of thing.
Sci-fi snob, are you a D&D fan?
I played it when I was a kid, but not really much anymore.
Chris,
I played it when
don't
I was those kids.
Anything else?
Yeah, no spoilers for Snob.
If you weren't a fan, then it would be. I would say, go ahead, spoiler away, Chris. But he did play.
Well, I know the references he makes, the Demogorgon. Remember, I've seen the first season, so the reference to the Demogorgon. We're about to get to the episode with the Ghostbusters. The first.
But wait, there's more. That's
yeah. There's. I'm not too worried about the spoilers. The show's been out for a while.
Okay. The other thing I was going to point out about Stranger Things is that yes, it. You were talking about Ghostbusters, Jason, but it actually brought Dungeons and Dragons into public awareness. As Chris said, it was well written, and people like me have always been playing it. Me and Death Angel Shadows have been gaming forever. But the fact is that the people got so invested in the characters in season one that they started looking into it and going, hey, exactly. I heard the geeks used to play that as a kid. Hey, man. What is this game about? And my gosh, there's like monsters and stuff, and it matches like what they're playing. What is it? So that brought it into from a minor awareness into full blown geekdom comes back again.
Well, I think some of it too is. It's another space for, this is popular. We need to get involved in it so that we can make sure that it's, modern sensibilities are honored. Because D&D, for all of its, popularity and flaws or whatever, I mean, you have everything now circling back to how do we make D&D acceptable to modern audiences? And Stranger Things is out there with D&D. Everybody's playing D&D, and we're talking about it. But the game when it was really at its height back in the 80s, it was still relatively obscure. People knew about it, but they didn't. It wasn't this huge popular thing. None of this stuff was huge popular thing. until suddenly, I don't know what year it just changed, but suddenly it was cool to be a geek, and all of this stuff was, I don't know if it was the Marvel Studios stuff that turned the corner on this, but there was a bit, there was a moment, I mean, Cam mentions Critical Role in the chat, there's this moment where we were no longer the unpopular, bullied on the playground kids. It was suddenly, you know, all of this stuff that we liked, suddenly everybody likes.
There were two phases where that, or two points where that came into, as they say, non-gamer public awareness. One, the first one that I recall is the big vampire craze in the early to mid 90s. What happens is that because of coincidentally, not, you know, like it's all running at parallel to each other, with the Anne Rice novels, Vampire the Masquerade game coming out, The Craft, all these other, like, oh, it's cool. It's cool to be a teen, and it's cool to be magical,
yeah,
as it were. And then it culminating with the TV series of Vampire the Masquerade.
All right, let me bring on Real Wade Nation Gaming joins us. Welcome.
Hey.
How are you?
Hey.
All right, so let's throw your two bits in. Lots of echoes today. I apologize. Apparently it's something inside StreamYards is messed up. So.
Yeah, I saw there's a button. I saw the buttons in audio for settings. There's a new one called Echo Cancellation, which you and also Reduce Mic Background Noise, which claims it's a new option. I don't know how new
that,
is new,
that echo but, that echo cancellation button has always been there.
Okay, but you Reduce Mic Background Noise.
Yeah, all of those. I don't know that any of that is new, but it could be. I don't know. I've been
playing with this the whole time. Doesn't do anything.
Doesn't do anything. Okay, so okay. It's something in StreamYard. We're gonna switch back to Zoom at some point here in the next week or so. So that'll take care of a lot of it right there. All right, Wade, what do you got? What's your two bits?
I just say I don't think Star Wars is gonna last very long, but that's just my hot take.
You don't think Star Wars is gonna last very long? Why is that?
No, just because of Acolyte.
I'll
watch it, but I won't. I'm not gonna watch it over and over. I haven't watched Star Wars much.
Yeah, there are a lot of people that have checked out and said, you know, I'm done. I'm not gonna watch Acolyte. I'm not gonna watch the next season of Andor. I'm not gonna watch whatever movie. I mean, there's been a delay on the Mandalorian Grogu movie, that's been pushed back. So. I don't know. I think Star Wars is...
You know, in contrast to that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been pretty much done. The only reason I came back was for Thrawn. Good or bad, whether you think he's good, a good interpretation from the book or not, I'm one of those, like, Thrawn shows up, here's my money.
I don't like the Thrawn that they've put in. I didn't like Thrawn in Rebels either. I think he's too soft. I think he's too soft spoken. I think he's too quiet. It was just one of those things where I was like, yeah, I don't know that I would have put Skarsgård in there as this character. I've never bought into the casting of that. So.
I saw the preview.
I agree
for
with
the
Jason
new
on
animated,
the Thrawn. I don't think there's been a good
show that's coming
out.
What's that, Cam?
The preview for the new animated series that's coming out that's based on Clone Wars or Rebels.
All right, Wade.
It has one of my favorite characters in it, which is.
Go ahead, Cam.
Okay, sorry. It's Barriss Offee from Clone Wars. she was another Padawan that was kind of teamed up with Ahsoka sometimes and betrayed her at one point. And I've always wondered what, you know, her story was going to be, and now they're making that pretty clear.
This is the new Tales of the Empire that we got a trailer for this week, and it looks like we're going to just get two stories out of however many number of episodes we're going to get, probably 8 or 10, I expect. And one of them deals with Barriss Offee and becoming an Inquisitor. The other one is what's her name from Ahsoka and how she came to be partnered up with Thrawn in pre-sequel days, I guess. So it's an interesting concept. I don't know. I don't know if I'll watch it or not. I might.
Well, I always suspected that Barriss was likely to be an Inquisitor.
Yeah.
But she didn't appear in Rebels as one. So I'm not, that's 15 years after, you know, the Inquisitors were established. So there's a lot of ground to, do work with her.
I think Wade says, sorry, I left. No, you're fine. You're fine. I mean, this is kind of a come and go party anyway, and we've been having these technical issues anyway, so I may wrap things up. Because I'm not hearing it right now, but I don't know. It sounds like StreamYard's got a bug in it. So
I've got two things.
Yeah, Chris.
Real quick. One of them is... the studio that brought you Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey, they've come out with that sequel, and yep, people are saying that the sequel is adequate, if not good. I don't understand the Rotten Tomatoes reviews or anything like that. I'm saying it's like a fantastic movie. From what I've seen, it's okay. It's markedly better than the first one. That being said, pretty much anything would be better than the first one.
What, well, you know they've announced a third one, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
They in fact have got a whole multiverse sort of thing now. That being said, that leads into what I wanted to speak about, because the first yesterday they dropped a trailer for Bambi: The Reckoning.
Oh, did they?
Yes. And it looks like it's going to be, I mean, from the trailer, it looks like it'll be a fun kind of creature feature, because they got Bambi and he's like really overpowered and he may or may not be like the zombie deer. Yeah.
I'm looking at it here. It looks a little creepy. Interesting cinematography here. This is, okay. This is gonna. Well, let me pull this up. Hold on here. Let's take a look, shall we? All right. Let me do that. This is the trailer for Bambi: The Reckoning. I don't know what's... It doesn't say it's red band, so we're taking our chances here.
You ever shot a deer?
No. What have you?
Are these guys from Scotland?
Yeah.
Is this in Scotland?
Once.
I didn't know Bambi was Scottish. So blonde long hair guy apparently is the guy who killed Bambi's mother. Okay. Ooh. Okay.
This is the Arnold Schwarzenegger School of Acting. acting.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, that's going
to
be...
I can't wait to see Thumper.
That's going to be silly. Oh, yeah, right? See, Thumper got a hold of the radioactive steroids.
I'm a bit disappointed. Or maybe it's something that they're holding over. Maybe they'll have a special appearance by Godzilla. Because remember, those two were in a movie together a long time ago. Right, Chris?
Oh, imagine, yeah. Mindy just pointed out we've yet to see Flower the Skunk.
That's true.
I mean, a monster kaiju acid version of Flower the Skunk. Can
Joker,
you imagine?
Joker acid flowers.
That looks
now,
that actually
the,
looks
the sequel to Blood and Honey. They did change the look of Piglet. Because, like, in the original Blood and Honey, it was much more like kind of a feral hog,
yeah,
with tusks and stuff like that. But now with the new one, he looks a lot more like the actual illustrations, yeah, of Piglet with that.
Yeah, Wade's saying we need a Fox and the Hound next. That works.
I'd rather see a behind-the-scenes movie about Bambi the Reckoning. And I'd like to see Bambi calling up his old buddies, trying to get them to come to his new movie, calling up Godzilla, calling up Thunder, and say, hey, come on, I need you to... And they'd be like, oh, you haven't worked in 20 years, 30, 40 years, Bambi. You know, I got my own career, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, by the way, speaking of calling up friends, I finally have a link... The Blasters and Blades podcast that I was a guest on, what now, two? How long ago was that? So the discussion of sidekicks has finally gone live. So let me put that up there while I'm thinking about this, because I had a good time. All right, so let me put that in the. In the chat. I don't know. Blasters and Blades probably, I think they have a Rumble channel too, so I'll do this. All right. All right. Y'all continue. Go about your business. Let me do this while I'm doing this.
I was going to say I finished watching season two of Invincible. it was kind of a disappointing ending. It didn't have I guess the best way of saying is they're preparing things for next season. Instead of having like a final point in the first season where it's kind of like, all right, your dad's a dick and he's gone off to and he's out of space out of a sense of remorse or whatever. So what you gonna do now, Mark? Season two is basically they're more about what's going on to his dad over in the Viltrumite prison near the end. But the thing is, it's more the last few episodes are more of a setup for the next season than anything else.
I haven't watched any of Invincible yet. There's so much out there I just haven't been able to keep up anything.
From a television standpoint, Invincible is one of the second, maybe third show that turns the idea of what superheroes are about on their head, like The Boys did.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as the comic books go, I'm not really sure which came first. But part of the stuff that was going on in the early 2000s was that everyone was trying to come up with innovation. I guess you could say, to actually turn things around. The comic book series, where you have the Japanese businessman who's like the most powerful psychic in the world, figuring that the only way to bring peace to the entire universe, I mean, to the entire planet, is basically take it over.
Yeah.
So
you're talking about Harbinger.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, because I didn't like the Harbinger series too much. What I like was the hardcore series, Harbinger Active Resistance Division, because that was the one where they plugged in the heroes, and they plugged in the ordinary people, and they gave them one hero, one power that they could turn on and off. And the thing is, eventually the power will kill them. And also I liked it because Dave Micheline was doing it. So there's that. And then, of course, there's Body Part Problem. Finally, Shogun, which I actually read the book a few times. And the thing is that for people who might be going on about stuff, that weird sex scene stuff in the first episode, that's actually in the book, quite literally. So I'm up to the middle of episode two, and they're following the book. So I'm going, like, if you don't like it, hey, in the 80s, they sanitized it from TV.
Yeah.
Back then.
I've been hearing some really good things about this new iteration of Shogun. Brian, that 70s rock fan, he's had a lot of positive things to say about it. And I haven't really seen very much harsh
Shogun's
criticism.
Been great.
So that's another thing that's on my list. But here's something here. Wade brought up, we are getting a re-release of The Mummy. And let me see if it's going to call up here. My tabs are moving really slow. The first Mummy with Brendan Fraser and that crowd, a 25th anniversary re-release, starting April 25th, 26th, and running through, I guess, a week. So there we go. It's going back into movie theaters through Fandango. You got Fandango, you got Adam Tickets have got it. I don't know if this is a Fathom Events thing, but anybody who's interested in The Mummy, it's coming back to theaters. So there's that. Anyway, thank you, Wade, for reminding me about that. I saw that this morning. People were starting to talk about it.
Another trend that's coming in, I've been watching YouTube videos all the time, and there is a new advertisement, it seems like. They're throwing anime full-length films on limited releases in theaters. So it's like, you know, check your local theater for such and such. And these are like old films. At first I was kind of excited for the idea, but then my son, who really is into anime, was telling me, oh, Dad, that's just an old movie. That's just an old movie that was for the TVC.
Yeah.
You know, this was in regards to Evangelion.
Well, I mean, we've been getting anime movies in the theaters for a while now, and then you had The Boy and the Heron, which is new, that won at least one Academy Award here this past last month. I've seen Princess Mononoke or I am completely not familiar with anime, so don't hold me to any of this stuff. But there are several anime things that have come through. Fathom, I think, has done a number of those screenings over the last, two, three, four,
they're
five
actually
years.
Doing a Studio Ghibli.
Yeah, Studio Ghibli.
Sort of like tour of when they're re-releasing the films. In fact, from April 27th through May 2nd, they're going to be bringing back Spirited Away.
Okay.
And that's one of their like landmark films. I guess maybe that's in response to the award-winning Boy and the Heron, that type of thing.
Well, I'm just saying it's a public awareness thing. Because I'm... If I'm not going out too much except for doctor's appointments, The thing is that I just get what's in the public awareness. If there's a YouTube commercial for it and it's about something that that I don't really have interest in, I'm going like, oh, somebody paid money for this thing. And even though I don't watch videos related to that, like getting a sport, why am I getting a sport commercial? I don't watch sport.
Yeah.
You know, things like that. So the thing, and for me, it's kind of surprising because I know this is a trend that's been coming up for a while now, making use of theaters for other things like the Doctor Who showings for things back in the early 2010s. Before that, in my experience, we only got the anime in theaters at art house places. In Chicago, there's a theater called the Music Box Theater that always plays. They always play stuff, but not first run famous stuff. They will play schlocky garbage films. They'll have anime weekends. They'll have all Hitchcock, like a Hitchcock cinema week. These are just examples, and that's what I'm saying. It's a trend that's coming up in our weirdness of liking sci-fi.
Yeah. All right. Well, I'm going to cut it off there because we're at an hour and the audio is just cutting in and out really bad. So, gentlemen, thanks very much for participating today. And thanks to all of you who are here with us live. If you are here after the fact, then I would say, okay, that is, all right, we're done with you there. Nationalists. All right. So that's it for today, folks. Thanks very much for being here. Next week, regular-ish schedule. The week after, the week of the 15th, no shows. So Sci-Fi Snob has plenty of chance to do shows of his own on his channel, and you can watch that. And
next time, anyway, live from the Grand Canyon, where we will be echoing.
We are going to take it. We're going to try to get over. We're going to try to get back over on Zoom, and that'll take care of some of that problem. So anyway, all right. Christopher, Michael, Snob, Cam, thanks for being here. Wade, thanks for jumping in, and we'll be back to do this all next week. Remember, the politicians hate you, the media lies to you, God has a plan for you, and there are four lights.
This has been a presentation of Sci-Fi for Me TV. Copyright 2024 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.